We've probably all seen videos on YouTube of spectacular diesel engine failures. And with some of these engines capable of producing 2,000 horsepower, it's no surprise that when they let go in a spectacular fashion. Well, in order to keep these engines together, more and more technology needs to be applied in terms of the engine components. And we're here with Drew from D&J Precision Machining to find out a little bit about this custom billet block Cummins diesel engine behind me. So, Drew, for a start, this Cummins engine that you've developed behind me, it's not quite dialed into its maximum performance, but you're expecting the ability to handle somewhere in the region of 3,000 horsepower, is that right?
Yes, yeah, we're looking for somewhere between 3,000 and 3,500 horsepower. That's about as far as our customers right now can handle with their chassis setups and stuff like that. Pretty sure we have the capabilities to go further than that if we need to in the future with the platform that we have here. But right now, like I said, the customers just really can't use it.
So let's start by talking about the factory Cummins block. And they're already capable of making pretty impressive power, at least for a street truck, in relatively stock form in terms of the components. Where have you found the sort of failure points for the stock Cummins block?
Yeah, in the 1,000 to 1,200 horsepower range typically, maybe a little bit more than that depending on torque base, we usually have problems with the blocks failing in the cylinder walls. So the first thing that we usually do is do a deck plate and a sleeve setup that strengthens the cylinder walls in the block. After that, we really can't get any more strength in the bottom end, and we've had engines that have blown apart right at the main web. So there's some pretty famous YouTube videos. It was actually one of our engines, and that's what sparked the development of this. We really could not strengthen the factory block in that area anymore, so we just decided to redesign the whole thing. So it starts with a 6.7 crankshaft because some of the rules that we have to deal with in the tractor pulling says that the stock 6.7 or the stock Cummins crankshaft has to be able to turn in the engine. So it's all based off a 6.7 Cummins platform, but that's about the end of it. Everything else has been redesigned by us to maximize everything that we can and make it as lightweight as possible.
You say it has to have the stock crankshaft be able to turn in the block. So essentially what you're saying there is it has to maintain that stock geometry for the crankshaft, but it doesn't mean you have to retain a factory crankshaft?
Correct, yes. This has a billet crankshaft, so it's been redesigned, billet, better material. But yes, the bore spacing has to stay the same. The centers between bores, all that has to stay the same.
Now, we've seen the sort of adoption of billet aluminium blocks, particularly in import drag racing, where people were just getting well beyond the capabilities of the stock cast iron blocks and the likes of the Toyota 2JZ. Obviously, that's a natural progression here in the diesel world as well. I'm interested in sort of finding out a little bit about the design strategy behind taking what is essentially just a massive chunk of alloy billet and deciding on exactly what design to use, where to put material, etc., and then validating it so you've got the confidence that that engine will in fact be able to support 3,500 horsepower.
Right, yeah, so we can simulate a lot of these things in SolidWorks, so we can stress test the block basically top to bottom for the block trying to blow apart top to bottom, and then decide where we can remove material, where we need to add material, how we want to put gussets in. So we settled on a steel bed plate setup, and it's got 6-bolt mains with 5/8 threads in the block to help take care of the foundation and the base. And then we go to a ductile iron sleeve with a 1-inch taller deck height, 1-inch longer connecting rod to help straighten out the rod angles.
So that's to improve the rod to stroke ratio?
Yeah, exactly. Rod to stroke ratio and straighten the connecting rod and the bore.
I'm assuming you're also revving this a lot further than what a stock Cummins was ever designed to?
Yes, we are revving. Like a stock Cummins is designed to run about 3,500 RPM. And we've had our cast engines at 8,000 before.
Yeah, okay, that's a massive difference. Now, you also mentioned a steel bed plate. So can you just talk us through what exactly that term means?
Yeah, so typically a block has a main cap, right? So main cap, and it sets down inside of a saddle. So we split the block basically at the parting line of the main bearing and put a steel bed plate on the bottom. So the whole base of the block is a steel bed plate.
So that just provides additional strength and better support?
Right, yeah, so much stronger, much better support.
Now, in terms of the SolidWorks software you're talking about with the design here, so it's safe to assume you're talking about FEA analysis of the engine design?
Right, correct. Yeah, FEA analysis, we can put loads in any different position that we want. We can fill the intake plenum, for instance, with say 200 pounds of boost pressure and see where the failure points of that are. The customers in the drag racing world are really interested in lightweight components. So we set a goal for overall weight on the cylinder head, and really we only had like 10 pounds to work with the intake manifold on this engine. So it took us a lot of work just to get that to flow how we wanted it to, have the volume and the plenum that we wanted to, and then also not blow apart.
That's one of the key aspects there. Now, one of the problems, obviously, in terms of running massive cylinder pressures with a lot of boost, a lot of nitrous, which we'll get onto shortly, is maintaining good cylinder to block or head gasket integrity, that seal there. Is this an issue in the Cummins, and if so, how have you dealt with that?
It is an issue with all engines. This is unique. We actually did the head gasket. It doesn't have a head gasket. It's all O-ring sealed for all the oil passages. And then we are using a spring energized compression sealing ring to where we can actually pull the cylinder head off, service anything we need to do, put everything right back on. The spring energized C-ring is reusable for all instant purposes. It's something that was developed with aerospace and NASA stuff.
I believe they're used in the nuclear power generation industry as well for sealing?
Yeah, I think they are, yes. It's been very good for us so far. Very reusable, very good. So if the customer has anything, we've had guys blow turbos up, for instance, pull their head off at the track, clean the pieces off, and go back to work.
And my understanding with those C-shaped spring energized seals as well is that you've essentially got the cylinder pressure going out into the seal and helping expand it. So essentially, if the head lifts a foul or two, which can be inevitable, that C-spring can basically expand out, maintaining that seal?
Correct. That's exactly how it works. Yeah, it gives you some flexibility with the expansion and also the cylinder pressure loading. We're actually testing cylinder pressure in this this engine. It's the first time we've done that. We can see the whole pumping loop and everything, so we can see the intake, the exhaust stroke, the whole nine yards.
Safe to say for drag racing use, this is a dry block with no coolant in it?
Yes, this is a dry block application for drag racing and higher end sled pulling.
All right, so moving on to the cylinder head, because again, you've got an engine that in stock form was never designed to spin to 8,000 RPM, never designed for 3,000 plus horsepower, and particularly getting that airflow at high RPM, I can only assume, is a big challenge from that stock head. So in terms of going to a billet head there, does that flexibility help you? What changes have you made there, and how important is that billet head and maybe the cam in order to get airflow at high RPM?
It's very important. With this cylinder head, we were able to, stock head flows about 165 CFM. This head flows 395. And we also changed the port design on the exhaust side of this head. We kind of ran into a wall with the way the exhaust ports exit in the stock location. So we ended up patenting this solution, but we ended up splitting the exhaust valves on the exhaust side so we could run each valve out of its own port. It's a 24-valve cylinder head, so we have 12 exhaust ports on the cylinder head.
I did see that on the exhaust manifold and wondered what you were doing there. So where's the sort of pros and cons with that setup versus stock?
Well, we really haven't seen the end of it yet. So the idea is to be able to get more exhaust flow, and we could definitely see that in the cylinder pressure data. We were evacuating the cylinder very fast. Now when we start turning the power up, we were at like 1500 horsepower areas the last time we were testing. When we start turning the power up and we have more exhaust mass, hard to say exactly what's going to happen there, but it's a big thing just trying to get rid of everything.
All right, so talking about getting the airflow into that engine, so what's the turbo setup that you're running?
In this application, we're running just a single GT55 98 millimeter. We have other applications with sled pullers where we're running compounds, triple turbos. This application is drag racing, and it's not been worth the weight to carry the big turbos down the track. So we're a single turbo with nitrous, and then a lot of times we'll run air-to-water intercoolers. It's the best way to make power for sure. But in this application, we're doing water injection, and that, again, is the same reason. It's just for weight. It has not been worth the extra power to make an air-to-water cooler go down the track.
So essentially sacrificing potentially maybe a little bit of power to reduce that weight, and your net result is improved ET a mile an hour?
Yeah, well, it doesn't really sacrifice the power. Since we don't have any rule constraints in this application, we can run nitrous, we can run whatever size turbo we want. We can just run more nitrous or bigger turbocharger or anything like that and still net the same power. So it's not as an efficient way of making power, obviously, as an air-to-water intercooler would be. But at the end of the day, it hasn't been worth the difference. We've still been able to make as much power as we need to get everything to do what it needs to do.
Now, I just want to come back to that turbo setup there, because we do see a lot of compound turbocharging used in the diesel tuning world, particularly for sled pulling, etc. And the single turbo on face value might be a small sacrifice in boost response, and also there you don't have the boost multiplication effect of a compound turbo, so you wouldn't be able to run, for example, on a single turbo generally maybe 200 psi and still work in an efficient area of the compressor map.
Right.
So is it just the fact that you can run the nitrous to get around that to get the power you want without needing massive boost pressure here?
Not necessarily. We can run big single turbos. I mean, we've run turbos up to 5-inch diameter on these engines. They're 410 cubic inches. Those turbos will make just as much power as most compound setups, but like you said, it's the drivability. So in certain applications like sled pulling, they typically run compounds, so they can run a lower RPM and they have a wider power band. A big single turbo can make the same amount of power, but a lot of times it's just in a lot narrower power band.
And for drag racing, you can obviously work with that narrower power band,
yeah.
Plus you've got the nitrous there to get the turbo up on boost initially.
Right, yeah, we can use spool jets, we can use different stages of nitrous at different times down the track. That's the key to drag racing, at least from what we've found so far, is power management. You have to be able to apply the power when you need to and take it away when you need to. And that gives us lots of flexibility with the fuel system that's on this engine, the nitrous, the whole nine yards.
Right, so that's a good segue into that fuel system and the nitrous as well. So starting with the nitrous there, you just mentioned stages, and interestingly, it looks like you've got what is a conventional gasoline wet direct port setup.
Yeah.
But of course, injecting diesel through a wet nitrous system would be of no use. So tell us how that works.
Yeah, we actually use a wet nitrous system, but it's actually just two stages of nitrous into the same nozzle.
And then you mentioned spool valves as well. So just talk us through how that works.
Yeah, well, we have different spool jets that come on. Spool jets that come on at different times. So when we're up against a torque converter, once we see a certain fuel quantity, a certain EGT, the one spool jet will turn on with the ECU. And then once we get to a little bit higher fuel quantity and a little higher EGT, the second one will kick on. And that's just to stage. So once that happens, when we come off the button with a trans brake, another stage comes on, and then everything's timed out after that.
Probably a good place to actually ask, what sort of ETs are you seeing from these combinations? And again, obviously, you haven't got this thing running at its full potential yet. So in your existing applications using cast blocks, how fast are you running?
Yeah, in our cast blocks, we've been 425 at 177 mile an hour in the eighth in a 3,150 pound truck.
And where are you sort of expecting with all in, let's say 3,000 horsepower, where would you expect to get to?
Hopefully this year, if everything goes well and we can get the chassis to cooperate, we should be well into the threes this year.
That's pretty serious, no matter what fuel you're running on there. So talking about that fuel system again, so we've talked about the nitrous. Obviously, you've got to get the diesel fuel in there as well, and a huge quantity of that, and that can be problematic. Can you talk us through the fuel system in terms of the pumps and the injectors you're running?
Yeah, Exergy is helping us with our fuel system. So right now we start with a low pressure pump that supplies about 15 psi of pressure to the CP3 pumps. The CP3 pumps are high pressure pump, are feeding like a 500% over injector. So 500% bigger than stock, basically, injector. And that's all controlled with a Bosch ECU. And Exergy Performance is helping us with all that stuff. Phil DeVries has been just invaluable to this whole package.
All right, Joe, it's been great to get some insight into the project. And not only is it potentially going to make 3,000 plus horsepower, it is an engineering work of art. So we wish you all the best once you get this back on the dyno in a week or so's time, and look forward to hearing your results. Thanks for the chat there.
Yeah, we're supposed to leave here and go right to the dyno. So it should be fun.
Hopefully it's not another one of those YouTube clips that you don't want out there.
Yeah, it happens. It's part of testing. Hopefully not.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thanks.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.